to introduce the chairperson of the Institute for International and European Affairs, Rory Quinn.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to you all, Ambassador, distinguished guest. On behalf of the Institute, I'd like to formally welcome you. The Institute for International and European Affairs was established over 25 years ago, and recently we have decided that we should have a dedicated institute within the family of the institutes focused specifically on Ireland and China. You are a very distinguished person in your own right, and representing, as you do, amongst your many different responsibilities, the largest bank in the world by any metric of comparison. And for that reason, and for many other reasons, you are most welcome to be with us.
Thank you, Rory. I think one of the main aims, and this is the brainchild, the Ireland-China Institute, I have to say, is the brainchild of Dr. Brendan Halligan here, who first came to discuss the idea. And we're very happy that we would work as a think tank within the, if you like, the environs of the Institute for International and European Affairs. And I'd like to thank its chairperson for hosting and assisting us. While I'm thanking people, I think to be able to invite Dr. Yang, of such notable reputation, could not have been done without the assistance and the help of our current ambassador of the People's Republic of China, Dr. Yu Xiaoyong. And I'd like him maybe to say an address and say a few words.
You know, we just had a visit of Party Secretary Hu Chunhua from Guangdong, and we see him off at his entourage off yesterday. And this is a very important visit, or we say the most important visit since this year. Both sides talk a lot of cooperation, exchanges, and give a lot of impetus for the relations. And it shows great momentum of our bilateral relations between China and Ireland. And one of the delegation, Hu Chunhua Suji, during all the visit, the boast to say is Guangdong occupies or produce 10% of the total GDP of China, 25% of the total trade of China. 他就说啊，广东这个占全国这个经济的10%以上，这个贸易25.9%以上， and the trade is both trade and the GDP of Guangdong is by the terms, by the quantity of 1 trillion and up. 就是中工商银行的这个是23万，是25万亿人民币， 那个广东的贸易是1万亿美元， 大概也就是6万亿，7万亿人民币。 And we have the president of the biggest bank in the world today. So I'm sure this creation of this forum and this series of speech by the leadership of this institute will really present us and this country a very good channel for Ireland to understand more of China and to know those leaders in all walks of life, to say the least, and the banking and the services leaders of China, so that we can continue to input the more energy and the vitality into this very promising and very prosperous relations, to deepen our understanding, to know more people face to face, and to deepen our relations. Thank you very much, and thank you all. Wish this presentation, I'm sure, will be a complete success.
Dr. Yang Kaisheng, PhD of Economics and Management School of Wuhan University. Dr. Yang was the Vice Chairman and President of Industrial and Commercial Bank of China Limited. Now he is a special advisor to the China Banking Regulatory Commission, academic advisor to China Finance 40 Forum, academic advisor to Institute of Digital Finance, Peking University. He's also tutor of PhD students at Financial Research Institute of People's Bank of China, and part-time professor at China University of Political Science and Law and the School of Economics, Peking University. It is my great pleasure to ask Dr. Yang to address you now.
尊敬的各位嘉宾、女士们、先生们，大家好。
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon.
非常高兴有机会在这里与大家分享关于中国经济金融形势的看法。 中国经济近几年来增长的速度有一定的下降，这个引发了国内外的关注。与此同时呢，中国银行业的风险状况究竟怎么样，能不能够保持健康稳健的运行，也是大家十分关注的一个焦点。今天我想借这个机会，与各位就中国经济银行业的发展情况进行一些交流。
It gives me great pleasure to share with you my views on the current situation in the economy and banking sector of China. In recent years, China's GDP growth has slowed down, triggering worldwide attention. Meanwhile, another heated topic about China is the risk condition of Chinese banks and whether the financial system can operate in a healthy and stable manner. Today, I would like to take this opportunity to present some and exchange some ideas about the trends of Chinese economy and banking sector.
首先呢，我想谈谈应该如何看待中国的宏观经济运行的态势。不少朋友看到这些年来中国经济的增速出现了一定的下降，担心这种下滑的趋势会不会长期的持续下去，并且不可遏制。
First, I would like to talk about how we should view China's macro economy. For some friends, after they see that China's economic growth has slowed down for the past few years, they are worried that this trend will continue for a long time and cannot be stopped.
我想说明的是，所谓中国经济增速的下滑，是与前些年9%、10%。 甚至10%以上的高速超高速的增长相比较而言呢，目前实际的6%到7%的增长速度，对 GDP 达到11万亿美元的一个巨大的经济体来说，是不能够认为偏低的。
I would like to point out that the so-called slowdown of Chinese economic growth came into being after comparison with the extremely high growth rates of 9%, 10%, or even higher rates in the previous years. China's current GDP growing at 6 to 7% in the last few years must not be judged as too slow for a huge economy of China at 9.78 trillion euros.
我也建议朋友们除了关注经济的增长速度之外，更需要重视的是经济结构的合理性问题。 和增长的质量问题。坦率地说，目前中国经济增长速度的变化，在一定程度上是我们主动调整的结果。所以，我们现在把中国目前经济发展的阶段称之为新常态。And
I suggest that we should not only focus on the growth rate, but also focus on the rationality of economic structure and quality of our growth. Frankly speaking, our current changes of economic growth rates are, to some extent, a result of the active adjustments made by the Chinese government. So we call the current situation of Chinese economy as new normal.
目前，中国的经济出现了很多积极的变化，一些关键的指标明显的改善。我认为，随着中国经济结构的改革的不断深入。 经济增长的内生动力正在急剧和增强，发展质量也在不断的提高。Up
to now, we have seen some positive changes growing up in Chinese economy, with some key economic indicators prominently improved.
With deepening economic restructuring, I believe that China is now steamed up again with new driving forces of growth and improved, better quality of development.
我愿意呢就此做一些介绍。一是中国的经济运行已经出现了新的稳定性。目前，中国经济的增长速度已经从前几十年的两位数的高速增长转为6%到7%的增长，同时经济增长也由投资出口拉动转变为向消费拉动。我认为这种运行态势与过高的增长速度相比更健康，也更可持续了。
I would like to elaborate more. First, a new stability has appeared within Chinese economy. In the past decades, China kept a double-digit GDP growth rate, which is now eased to 6% to 7% every year. At the same time, economic growth has transformed from previously relying on investments and exports to now being driven by consumption. In my view, compared with faster economic growth rates, such a present growth rate and growth pattern is healthier and more sustainable.
为什么这么说呢? 中国2015年经济增长的速度是 6.9%, 2016年是 6.7%, 今年一季度是 6.9%, 经济增长速度在各个季度之间的波动性很小, 保持了增速的稳定, 除此之外, 就业, 物价, 收入也都是稳定的。
Why do I say that? Because the GDP growth rate was 6.9% in 2015, it was 6.7% in 2016, and it was 6.9% in the first quarter of this year. So the growth rates now are very stable between the years and quarters, with just minor changes. Besides, indicators about employment, CPI, and income have all been very stable.
在就业方面, 2016年中国城镇新增就业 1314万人, 2016年末城镇的登记失业率是 4.02%, 是多年来的一个比较低的水平, 这对于13亿人口的发展中大国来说十分不容易, 也十分重要。
For employment, we can see that 13.14 million people have been newly employed throughout last year in China's urban areas, and the registered unemployment rate in China was 4.02% in urban areas in China. This was a relatively low level in the past few years. Given China's population of 1.3 billion, this stable employment was no easy task, and it was very important to us as a huge developing economy.
在物价方面, 2016年, 中国的CPI 同比上涨了 2.0, 今年一季度, CPI是 1.4%, 刚刚过去的5月份, CPI 同比增长是 1.5%, 比上个月下降了 0.1%。 PPI 自从2016年9月份, 结束了连续54个月的同比下降之后，转为上升，增长的幅度是逐月扩大的。今年一季度 PPI 是 7.4%， 刚刚过去的5月份是 5.5%。我们认为这个数据在当前的情况下是可以接受的，而且对整个经济的增长也发挥了一定的拉动作用。
For CPI, it was 2.0% in 2016, and in the first quarter of this year, it stood at 1.4%. In May, just last month, it was 1.5% and was down by 0.1% over April of this year. On the other hand, the PPI, the Producer Price Index, started to increase with higher and higher growth rates month over month since September of 2016. That was after 54 months of consecutive declines over the past months. And it reached 7.4% in the first quarter of this year. In May, just last month, PPI was 5.5%. We believe that this is not only acceptable at present, but also very conducive to promote economic growth rate.
在收入方面, 2016年, 全国居民的人均可支配的收入实际增长 6.3%, 今年一季度实际增长 7.0%, 中国的居民生活水平有了进一步的提高。
For the income indicators, the real average disposable income of Chinese residents increased by 6.3% in last year and by 7.0% in the first quarter of this year. This leads to better living conditions for Chinese residents.
二是中国的经济结构性的改革效果是明显的，例如过剩产能 已经并在正在继续的压缩之中。
Top on the stability, secondly, our economic restructuring also is proving to be quite effective. For example, the overcapacity has been and is still being reduced right now.
中国2016年全年退出了钢铁产能超过6500万吨，煤炭产能 退出超过了2.9亿吨, 应该说是超额完成了去年的全年度目标任务。
In 2016, last year, China cut more than 65 million tons of production capacity of iron and steel and cut over 290 million tons of coal capacity. These both exceeded the annual reduction targets set at the start of last year.
今年 中国仍将继续压缩钢铁产能5000万吨，煤炭产能1亿5000万吨，目前已经分别压缩了63.4%和46%。
For this year, China will further reduce overcapacity of 50 million tons of iron and steel and 150 million tons of coal. Up to now, China has achieved, respectively, 63.4% and 46% of both these reduction targets.
房地产市场也进一步趋向了健康和理性。一二线的城市的房价趋稳的态势比较明显。三四线城市去库存的进程是不断的加快。2016年底, 全国商品房待售面积同比下降了3.2%。今年一季度延续了持续下降的趋势，降幅达到了6.4%。The
Chinese property market also tends to be healthier and more rational. The housing prices in China's Tier 1 and Tier 2 cities have sufficiently stabilized, and the process of reducing inventory in China's Tier 3 and Tier 4 cities is now stepping up. By the end of last year, the total area of residential housing for sale in China decreased by 3.2% year on year, and such a trend continued in the first quarter of this year with a drop by 6.4%.
这个这里我们把一线二线三线四线再稍微解释一下，就是，中国我们通常说的一线二线城市是指中国的特大型和大型城市，比如说北京、上海、广州、深圳等等，当然也包括有些省会，比如南京等等，这叫一线二线，就是价格人口很多，城市规模很大这样的城市。至于三线 四线呢，主要是指城市规模相对较小的，比如说，省里面的二级城市、省会以下的城市，甚至一些县一级的城市。当然了，我们那些城市的人口，如果和欧洲的一些国家相比，就很难说小了。三线、四线，也许有100万人口、200万人口。I'd
like to provide more explanation about some terms in my speech right now. Tier 1, Tier 2, and 3, 4 cities. What does that mean? For Tier 1 and Tier 2 cities in China, we mean basically the mega cities in China with over several tens of millions of residents. For example, Shanghai, Beijing, Guangzhou, Shenzhen, and the capital cities of China's provinces in different parts of China. For Tier 3 and Tier 4 cities, they are smaller cities in some provinces in China with 1 million or 2 million people, residents. Of course, we understand that 1 million and 2 million in European context still make up for a very big city here.
中国目前企业的杠杆率上升的态势也得到了一种遏制。今年三月末，中国的工业企业的资产负债率是56.2%，同比下降了0.7个百分点。
And the rising trend of corporate leverage ratio in China has been curbed. By the end of March of this year, the leverage ratio of industrial enterprises with sizable scale in China was 56.2%, and down by 0.7 percentage points over the same period last year. This was discussed also during our lunch just now with our host.
目前消费在中国 已经成为了经济增长的重要的拉动的力量。2016年，最终的消费支出对国内生产总值增长的贡献率是64.6%，连续四年稳步提升，比2007年又提高了19.3个百分点。今年一季度，消费贡献率进一步提升到了77.2%。
Nowadays, consumption in China has become an important driving force for our economic growth. Last year, the final consumption contributed to 64.6% to GDP growth, with a steady increase for the last 4 years, and the contribution rate at 64.6% of GDP growth is higher by 19.3 percentage points in the year 2007. In the first quarter of this year, this contribution rate was even higher to 77.2%.
与此同时呢，投资与出口也有比较积极的表现。2016年，中国的固定资产投资同比增长了8.1%，今年一季度 同比又增长了9.2%，其中制造业的投资和民间投资回升比较明显。自从2016年9月份以后持续回升，2017年的一季度同比又分别增长了5.8%和7.7%，增长速度比去年全年又分别加快了1.6个百分点。
At the same time, investments and exports were also doing very well. The investments in fixed assets in China increased by 8.1% year on year in last year and by 9.2% in the first quarter of this year. Among the investments, those into manufacturing industry and private investments had a very strong recovery, with a constant pickup since September of 2016. And these were up by 5.8% and 7.7% respectively in the first quarter of this year. The growth rates were higher than last year by 1.6 percentage points and 4.5 percentage points respectively.
我们的产业机构在持续的优化。 第一产业、第二产业的比重继续的下降。第三产业自从2007年以来，10年来一直保持上升的势头。2016年，第三产业的增加值占整个国民生产总值的比重达到51.6%，比2007年提高了12.6个百分点。The
industrial structure also kept optimizing, becoming better. The proportions of primary and secondary industries in Chinese economy are decreasing, while the proportion of the tertiary industry has kept a growing momentum since 2007. In last year, the value added of the tertiary industry accounted for 51.6% of the GDP, and it's up by 12.6 percentage points compared to the proportion in 2007.
在第二产业的内部，制造业出现了高端化、智能化的倾向。 2016年，中国的高技术的制造业、装备制造业增加值分别增长了 10.8% 和 9.5%， 增长速度高于整个工业企业的平均的 4.8% 和 3.5 个百分点。 2016年，新材料、节能环保 等新兴产业工业增加值同比增长了 10.5%， 旅游、文化、体育、健康、养老等产业快速发展，分享经济呢广泛的渗透。
Within the secondary industry, the manufacturing sector is also moving towards high-end manufacturing and smart manufacturing. Last year, the value added of high-tech manufacturing increased by 10.8%, and the value added of equipment manufacturing increased by 9.5%. They are both 4.8 percentage points or 3.5 percentage points higher, respectively, than the average growth rates of all industrial enterprises above sizable scale. The value added of strategic and emerging industries such as new materials, energy conservation, and environmental protection went up by 10.5% year on year in last year. And the service sectors, including tourism, culture, sports, healthcare, and elderly care, have developed very quickly. And now in China, we have seen a thriving sharing economy.
第三方面呢，我还愿意介绍一带一路建设所取得的积极的进展。最近几年，中国对外开放呢向纵深发展，特别是与一带一路的沿线国家的贸易稳步发展，双向投资都出现了高速的增长。Thirdly,
I'd like to say a few words about the Belt and Road Initiative. This initiative is making very strong progress. Nowadays, China has deepened its opening up to foreign countries. Particularly, our trade with countries along the Belt and Road Initiative is developing very fast, and bilateral investments are witnessing rapid growth as well.
在全球贸易比较低迷的情况下， 2016年中国与一带一路沿线国家的贸易额达到了 6.3 万亿元人民币的新高。
Let me provide some numbers. In 2016, the trade value between China and the countries along the Belt and Road Initiative rose against the backdrop of a sluggish global trade, and it reached a record high of 822 billion euros.
2017年的一季度，中国与一带一路的沿线国家和地区经贸合作呢继续升温，双边的贸易额同比增长了 26.2%。 相比较去年呢，扩大了25.6个百分点。
In the first quarter of this year, we can see that China's economic and trade cooperation with those countries still continued to warm up, and the trade value was uplifted by 26.2% year on year, and this was 25.6 percentage points higher than that rate of last year.
2016年，中国的企业对“一带一路”沿线的 50多个国家直接投资达到了145.3亿美元。目前，中国的企业已经在20多个国家建设了56个经贸合作区，为有关国家创造了将近11亿美元的税收和18万个就业的岗位。
In 2016, direct investments by Chinese enterprises in the 53 countries along the Belt and Road Initiative reached 12.9 billion euros. And up to now, Chinese enterprises have set up 53 trade and economic cooperation zones in over 20 countries, creating nearly 978 million euros of tax revenue and about 180,000 jobs for those countries.
中国 是共建“一带一路”的倡议者，也是负责任、有担当的实践者。中国在实现自身改革发展的同时，愿意为推动世界经济持续增长提供动能。今年五月份，在北京召开的“一带一路”国际合作高峰论坛取得了丰富的成果，在对接政策和发展战略、推进经济走廊建设、加强重大项目合作、加大资金支持等方面提出了多项的新举措，达成了一系列的新共识，为进一步推进“一带一路”建设提供了重要的基础和保障。
China is the advocate for the Belt and Road Initiative, and we are a responsible country to put the initiative into practice. While carrying our own reforms and development, China is willing to provide new engines for a sustainable growth of world economy. The Belt and Road Forum for International Cooperation held in Beijing last month, it has delivered tangible results. Those participating countries from around the world into this forum last month brought up multiple new measures for policy alignment, development strategies, economic corridor construction, cooperation on key projects, financial support, etc. And we have reached a series of new consensus. These has laid sound foundation, an important guarantee for the promotion of Belt and Road Initiative.
从上面我刚才说的几点可以看出，中国经济发展长期向好的基本面没有变，中国的经济增长仍然具有韧性好、潜力足、回旋余地大的特点。中国经济未来发展的空间和潜力还是十分广阔的。作为一个银行家，我本人对中国经济的未来发展是有信心的。
As you can see from the information above, we feel that the fundamentals for a growing Chinese economy in the long term have not changed. China's economic growth has strong resilience, large potential, and sufficient space for maneuver, and it enjoys broad development prospects. As a banker, a former banker, I'm very confident in Chinese economy.
第二部分呢，我想谈谈怎么样看待中国银行业的经营发展情况。我想时间好像还够，所以我想这么谈一谈中国银行业的这个经营情况。最近几年来，有些朋友似乎对中国银行业的经营状况有点担心。例如，中国银行业的不良资产率究竟是多少？随着中国经济增长速度的下滑，银行业的风险会不会加大等等。我愿意向大家提供一些数字。
Next, I would like to share my ideas about how we should view China's banking sector. In recent years, some friends have serious concerns about Chinese banks. For example, what is the real NPL ratio of the sector? And will the bank's risks in China be amplified by the slowdown of Chinese economy? Here, I would like to present some statistics about our banks.
第一就是中国银行业的资产和负债的规模继续保持了两位数的增长。2016年末，中国银行业金融机构资产的总额是232万亿人民币，同比增长了15.8%。2017年的一季度增长速度是14.3%。2016年末，中国银行业金融机构负债的总额达到215万亿元人民币，同比增长16%。2017年的一季度增长的幅度是14.5%。
First of all, the balance sheet of Chinese banks sustains a double-digit growth. By the end of 2016, the total assets of Chinese banks stood at 3.02 trillion euros, up by 15.8% year on year. And this number grew by another 14.3% in the first quarter of this year. The total liabilities of Chinese banks stood at 2.8 trillion euros, up by 16.0% year on year, and this number it grew by 14.5% in the first quarter of this year.
第二就是中国银行业的盈利能力仍然十分强大。
Second, the profitability of Chinese banks is very strong. The total net profits of Chinese commercial banks throughout last year, for 1 year, stood at 215.2 billion euros. It went up by 3.54% year on year. In the first quarter of this year, the growth rate of Chinese banks' net profits was still up again by 4.61%.
中国的几家大银行, 比如说, ICBC, BOC, 他们的利润额, 这些年来一直是位于全世界第一和第二。
In recent years, the net profits of China's largest banks, such as ICBC and CCB, have ranked number one and two in the whole world.
2016年, 中国商业银行的资产回报率和净资本回报率, 也就是 ROA 和 ROE, 分别是 0.98% 和 13.38%, 在国际同业中处于比较好的水平。 我们知道去年欧元区主要银行的 ROA 和 ROE 分别是 0.5% 和 7.8%, 美国的银行业的 ROA 和 ROE 分别是 1.04% 和 9.34%, 和他们相比, 中国的银行业的 ROA ROE 水平呢, 仍然是处于一个比较好的水平。
Last year, the return on asset and return on equity of Chinese commercial banks stood respectively at 0.98% and 13.38% respectively. These numbers are both at a very sound level among global peers, because if we see the Eurozone competitors, we see that the ROA for Eurozone commercial banks last year was 0.5%, and the ROE was 7.8% for major Eurozone banks. And for American banks, these numbers were respectively 1.04% and 9.34%.
第三点就是中国银行业的资产质量在持续的改善。 2016年末, 中国银行业的不良贷款率是 1.74%, 环比下降了 0.01%, 与欧美银行业相比, 仍然处于一个比较好的水平。 我们知道同期, 欧元区主要银行的不良贷款率是 2.8%, 美国银行业的不良贷款率是 2.12%, 而且中国银行业, 有较为充足的不备。 2016年, 我们的不备覆盖率达到了 176.4%, 远高于国际平均水平。
Third, the asset quality of Chinese banks keeps changing for the better. By the end of 2016, last year, the NPL ratio of China's banking sector as a whole stood at 1.74%, down by 0.01 percentage points quarter on quarter. This is also of a sound level among global peers, because if we look at the major banks in the Eurozone, this figure, NPL ratio, was 2.8% averagely, and for American banks, it was 2.12%. Besides, there are adequate loan loss provisions for Chinese banks. The average provision coverage ratio for Chinese commercial banks was 176.4% by the year end of last year, much higher than the average of global peers.
第四点就是中国的银行业的资本充足率仍然保持着较高的水平。 2016年末, 中国的商业银行核心一级资本充足率分别是 10.75%, 11.25% 和 13.28%, 符合巴塞尔三的监管要求。
Fourth, the capital adequacy ratio of Chinese banks is still high. By the end of last year, the core Tier 1 capital adequacy ratio of Chinese banking sector was 10.75%. The Tier 1 capital adequacy ratio was 11.25%, and the total capital adequacy ratio was 13.28%. And all these three have met the Basel III requirements.
根据英国的杂志《银行家杂志》 2016年度全球1000家银行的排名 2016年度中国上榜的银行数量再创新高 有119家银行进入了全球1000家银行的这个排序 中国的四大银行都排名在前十 中国最大的银行 同时也是全世界最大的银行 就ICBC 更是连续四年名列一级资本全球第一
According to the Banker magazine, 119 Chinese banks were among the top 1,000 world banks. This number is a new record for Chinese banks. And the biggest four Chinese banks are all among the top 10 banks in the world. Moreover, ICBC, the largest bank in China and in the world as well, has ranked number one for the fourth consecutive year in terms of Tier 1 capital.
中国的银行业正在积极地顺应形势的要求，不断地转变自身的经营理念，加快转型创新的步伐。例如，银行正在加快从单一的融资中介向综合的金融服务商转变。At
present, Chinese commercial banks are changing our operational ideas and stepping up the transformation and innovation to better adapt to the new environment. For example, banks are transforming from a simple financing intermediary to a provider of comprehensive financial services.
在中国的产业结构，从高能耗、重资产的重化工业，向清洁化、轻型化、智能化方向升级的过程当中，企业增加研发投资、整合经营资源以及兼并重组等活动，在获得传统的银行贷款支持的同时， 也必然会提出更广泛的综合金融的需求。商业银行将由单一的融资中介向股权加债权加贷款加代理加顾问五位一体的综合化的金融服务商转变。As
China's industrial mix is upgrading to become cleaner, lighter, and smarter rather than those high energy consumption or high pollution industries, the Chinese enterprises will surely increase their R&D investment to consolidate their resources, and they will go through necessary acquisitions and restructuring. So for Chinese enterprises, while they still ask for ordinary loans from banks, they will surely ask for more extensive and diversified financial services from Chinese banks. As a result, these banks will have to provide a full spectrum of financial services, including loans, bonds, equity, agency, and consultancy services.
随着大数据和信息化技术的快速的发展，中国的银行业正在加快推动科技与金融业务的融合创新，将科技创新的优势与线下银行网点的服务优势相结合，全面地构建线上线下一体化的互联网的金融生态体系。
With the fast development of big data and IT technologies, Chinese banks are pressing ahead with fintech innovations. By incorporating fintech with offline services in physical outlets, Chinese banks now offer a comprehensive financial ecology that offers O2O services, online to offline services.
我们可以以我原先服务的工商银行为例，作为一个科技大行、数据大行。 工商银行依据强大的信息技术运用和数据的处理能力 深入推动了EICBC 互联网金融的发展
Take ICBC for example. As a leading bank of IT application and data processing, ICBC has promoted the EICBC strategy to better develop internet finance.
2016年末 工商银行的开放式的网络银行的平台客户数达到了 2亿5300万户 工商银行的即时通讯平台的客户数达到了6649万户，比年初增长了10倍。工商银行的电商平台年交易额达到了12,700亿，比年初增长了44%。工商银行的网络融资业务的余额增长幅度达到了20.2%。
In ICBC, we have an open online banking platform, and the number of users of this banking platform has reached 254 million, 53 million by the end of 2016. In ICBC, we also have our own instant messaging platform, and by the end of last year, the number of users of this messaging platform was 66.49 million users. In ICBC, we also have an e-commerce platform, and by the end of last year, the transaction value of transactions processed on the e-commerce platform was 16.5 billion euros. This has grown by 44% over the start of 2016, and the total loan book of our internet financing has grown by 20.2% in last year.
实体经济是金融生长的土壤，两者呢是互利共赢的，兴衰与共。金融的要义就是要服务好实体经济。如果实体经济不能保持健康的发展，金融业的稳健发展就会失去根基。如果金融脱离了实体经济，搞所谓的创新和自我的循环，不仅会对实体经济造成损害，自身的发展也注定难以长久。
The real economy is the soil to nurture financial sector. These two are mutually beneficial, and they share a common destiny. The defining purpose of financial sector is to serve the real economy. If the real economy fails to keep a healthy development, then financial sector would lose its root and lose its stability. On the other hand, if the financial sector breaks away from the real economy and is indulged in unproductive so-called innovations or self-circulation, then not only the real economy would be harmed, but also the financial sector itself would not sustain for long.
维护金融的安全，防范金融的风险，是金融体系功能正常发挥的一个基础，也是金融服务实体经济的本质的要求。目前，中国的银行业正在这些方面进一步的努力。
The foundation for normal functioning of a financial system is to ensure safety of financial activities and to prevent financial risks. These are also in line with the essential requirement for financial sector to service the real economy. Now, Chinese banks are working hard to fulfill this purpose.
女士们、先生们，在经济全球化继续发展的今天。 中国经济的发展离不开世界，世界经济的发展也需要中国。中国经济持续稳健增长的态势将延续。在这个过程中，我们十分愿意加强与世界各国经济金融业朋友们的合作，一起努力，互相交流，共同发展，共同创造合作多赢的发展机会。
We have, ladies and gentlemen, we have entered into an era of globalization where China's development and the world economy are inseparable from each other. China's sustainable and prudent growth will continue. We are more than happy to cooperate with friends from around the world, from the economic and financial sectors, to work together and exchange ideas with each other to create more opportunities for win-win development.
Thank you. Thank you for your attention.